Throughout the continental United States, there is a gathering of our automotive history. Most of you will not get to see or experience these icons of our youth, but I will, and I want to take you along with me on this wonderful journey. This is your time to connect with your automotive past. These vehicles and people are real. Many people have experienced a love affair with cars, the same as I have, and that's what this series is all about. We will also feature cars at a Wednesday night cruise. For the last 5 years, we have been collecting the video necessary to bring you some of the most beautiful classic, custom, and antique automobiles we can find. People have been the center point of the series because whenever you talk about restored cars, you must put a face of a human being with it. Therefore, we have attempted to, and I believe succeeded, in presenting in this classic car series, preserving a precious part of our automotive history. On today's show, we'll look at a 40 Ford Woody, owned by a good friend of ours.
In 1963, Studebaker released a very rare supercharged Avanti, and we have one to look at today. And to top off this week's program, we'll look at the museum-grade 1937 Buick Roadmaster.
Our friend Gavin knows quality in automobiles, so it's no surprise to have him pull into the Rock and Roll Diner in what has to be one of the finest representations of a Woody. The year was 1940. The U.S. had just a year before it was sent into absolute turmoil. As the Depression was easing, jazz was all the rage, and it was a good time for Cary Grant and Lauren Bacall at the movies. Bogie and Bergman were hot properties. Gone with the Wind with Clark Gable and Vivian Leigh swept the Oscars, in part with the scene that gave us Frankly Scarlet, I Don't Give a Damn. So what did we sit in front of for entertainment in the households of 1940? Where's the remote?
I'm sitting here with a gentleman named Gavin. Gavin has been to as many of these cruises that I've been to, and you brought a tremendous number of cars, different every time. But you brought one particular one. It's a Woody, and what would you say it was, a 71? I'm sorry, a 41.
My 1940 Woody.
It's a 40.
It's a 40 Woody.
You sure about that?
A 44. I was going to say something, but I won't.
But I had you thinking now, didn't I?
That's right.
Just a little bit, I had you thinking there, didn't I? Okay, I don't know. I'm going to have to do a lot of editing on this one, but that's okay. Now, where'd you get it? And was it in that shape when you got it?
The car is an original car. My brother-in-law purchased it in 1953, took it on trade for a 1953 Ford station wagon. And we've had it since that time.
Wow. So it came in that way?
It came in with the original top that's on it now. I haven't changed it. The interior upholstery, after sitting in the garage for 15 years,
yeah.
Stitching went.
Yeah.
Had to be restitched. The car has been repainted and refinished. But it's all original wood. Original interior has never been refinished.
What's it got for an engine in it? Flathead.
85 horsepower.
Yeah. 55?
85.
85, yeah.
It's a big engine.
Yeah. So when you got it, now you said, I'm going to put it all back together, and what are you going to do with it? Is it a cruiser? Or is it a, it's not a daily driver under spinny circumstances?
Well, actually, the car basically is a cruiser. It's not a daily driver, but we got the car with about a little less than 50,000 miles on it. And it currently, in 1972, I looked when I brought it up from New Hampshire, it had 70,000 miles on it. Now it currently has 80,000 miles on it.
So you're using it?
We use it. We drive it, and we drive it everywhere.
Right.
You know, we're careful about it, but we drive it everywhere.
Now, do you find, now that's got a wooden body on it.
Yes.
It's got a steel frame, steel fenders, all that other good stuff. Now, when you have you noticed any cracks or anything that takes place when it goes down the road?
Oh, creaks and groans like we do.
Yeah. You know? Like we do. No, I didn't quite mean it that way. I mean,
no, it creaks and groans. It does. It sounds like a wooden boat. It creaks and it groans.
Wow.
You know, it's a stiff ride.
Right.
On a road. But it basically is on a strong frame. It's on a convertible frame.
Yeah.
The frame is like between a convertible and a pickup truck frame. Right. It's a very
So there's no real stress on the actual body. That body is just riding down the road like the seats are.
Yep. But the body from the cowl back is all wood.
Yep.
I mean, you think about it, the fenders are mounted on the wooden frame, on the wooden body.
Yep.
And from the cowl forward,
what's that look like underneath? I've never thought about this, but is it wood under there? Or
it's metal? All metal.
Okay, so it is like a true convertible, because that convertible, they had a metal
pan
cross bracing and everything. Well, I guess that makes sense. That makes sense. They were first, the first ones that came out, they were used at like country clubs where they would go down to the train station and pick the people up in them.
This car hasn't got the third seat. The reason why it hasn't got the third seat, it was used at a Newton, Mass. Summer camp.
Yep.
And the reason the third seat was, we never were able to find it, get it because they couldn't find it. They used to put the suitcases at train station in the back, bring the kids to the camp, and then bring it back that way.
Yep. Because those.
That's where the name station wagon comes from.
Yeah. Station wagon. Wow, you know, honestly, I didn't know that. Oh my God, here
oh my
I
goodness,
am, 60-some years old, and I didn't know that. And you're right, you're absolutely right.
When you go beyond 70, you start remembering these things.
Ah, so okay, well.
You're just a young man.
Yeah, I've got a long way to go before I get to 70. Uh-huh. So what are your plans for? Hang on to it?
It's going to be passed on to the kids and the grandkids and the great-grandkids, I guess.
That's good.
All my cars will be passed on.
Yeah.
And the garages will be there for them to take, as long as they can afford them.
That's the next thing I got for you. How many you got?
Baker's dozen.
12, 13.
13.
13? All different sizes, shapes, or did you theme?
No theme. It's what I like at the time. When I see it, I buy it.
Okay.
And I've got everything from, you see my rat rod, and I've got, you know, and I got a regular, you know, street rod that I can show against anybody. Yeah. I got European.
I don't know
rods.
Why you call that a rat rod. That's not a rat rod.
Well, it's an old 50s rod.
Yeah.
It's, you know, more like a 50s rod. Well, it's ratty. It's not like all my other vehicles that are just up to par.
Right.
That has, you know, a little primer in the fenders and a few dents, you know, here and there.
Yeah, but you have to know. Well, you do. You know what a rat rod is.
I know.
I mean, you've seen them.
This is
rat rods, when they go down the road, you wonder if that guy's going to make it alive.
But this is my family's rat.
Yeah, okay.
They look at it that way.
Okay, well, it's the least rod you've got of all 13, right?
I tell my kids it's that way. It looks like that because it's a rat rod.
Okay.
It's not because it's one of Pop's cars.
Okay.
No?
Okay. Right. So what else you got? You got that one? And
I've got a 32 Ford Roadster. That's in Florida. 350 small block Chevy engine in it. That's really a show car. 33 Chevy pickup truck, which I'll probably bring here next week.
Good. We'll get a chance to take a look at that.
I got a 40. The pickup truck was restored in 1980, so it's all restoration. Mm. Used to be a farm truck. I've got the 40 Ford Woody.
We'll get a list from you. We understand. We understand.
It's hard to remember. It's like the kids' thing, you know. You're going to see them in the garage.
What's that? We'll come out there and do a show. Oh, yeah. We're going to come out there and do a show.
If you can. Love to have you.
Okay.
And my latest one, which will be on, hopefully you'll see
this
year.
That's my producer that was telling me from the season.
You're interrupting me.
I know.
You're not supposed to do that.
I know.
My latest one is a 61 Chrysler Crown Imperial convertible. It's a land yacht.
Wow. Yeah.
2 years of restoration. It should be on. It's going to the upholstery shop on the week of Monday. So it should be here before the season is over.
Yeah, that would be good.
No.
But we would. We'd like to come out there and take a look at them. And I understand you have some in Florida, and we might just come on down there and take a look.
Welcome.
Okay.
I'd love to have you.
Okay, you pay our way down, put us up.
I'll give you a bus there.
I could see us with our camera in January. She'd take it.
There you go.
In January, she'll take it.
Unfortunately, the roads are so bad, I wouldn't have you driving anything.
No. Listen, we appreciate it. We appreciate you keeping these things in a shape. They can go so quickly in today's day and age. We appreciate you keeping them.
Unfortunately, they are going quickly. The newer cars today are all going to the crusher.
Yes, they are.
And when you think about it, when we were kids, that wasn't a new car.
No.
That was a new car, I should say. You know.
It was a new car. That was a new car. For instance, I had a 40 Ford coupe. It wasn't an old car at the time. It was an older car.
Right, but it wasn't an old car.
That's right. That's right.
Oh, yeah. We used to race the 40 Fords
in
the stocks.
Oh, man. That used to bother. Oh, I think back on it now, going to the Friday night races, and you would see these 40 Ford coupes and Chevrolets, and they had cut them all up. Well, you know.
Keep up with the big engines. Buy old ones with the small 60 horsepower engines. Take them out and put the big one in.
Well, you know, and again, I don't know how much of this is going to appear on tape, but let me just tell you this. There was a place called Kleeman's Junkyard. He had a whole bunch of flatheads, you know, that he had taken out of wrecks. I mean, cars that weren't coming back. And he had the transmission still attached, everything, you know. And those were his racing engines. People would come in on a Wednesday, buy one of those engines. It would be racing on a Friday night. And then the car would be completely wrecked. They'd bring the car in, he'd pull the engine out and put it over here in a pile again. Somebody else would come in and buy those flatheads. Lasted
going forever.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So, but anyway, I would go out into his boneyard and see those 40 Fords and those old Chevys and the 32s and the 44s. Oh, God, I used to say to myself, why in the world did they cut those things up? But they did. Right?
We did it. We all did it. 1957, I had a 1949 Mercury, and I used to race, and I had then a 56 O's engine, which you could buy at the junkyard.
Rocket 88.
You can't do that in 98.
98, right?
Can't 98. Do it anymore,
no.
You know,
no.
Unfortunately. It's been Cadillac good. We could talk all day.
We could go for days.
That's right.
But I ain't got enough tape for that.
Thank
you're way over now.
Hi, this is Tim from Motorland, presenting our 1963 Studebaker Avanti from the Miles Collection. We're really excited to have the car here at Motorland because it's a very rare example of a car that was a stunning design when it was first introduced in 1963. In fact, I like to talk to people and say, if this was a new car design that was rolling out for 2018, it would still look like a credible offering because it's a very modern, timeless design. As you look at this particular car, notice the outside paint. It's all original. So that beautiful turquoise paint has not been repainted. So this car is eligible for preservation class status. If you look under the hood, it's powered by the rare R2 supercharger, which is a very highly desired option for this car. In addition to the R2 supercharged option, it's mated with a 4-speed transmission. The Avanti originally came with a factory 3-speed, and you could upgrade it to an automatic. You could also upgrade it to a 4-speed, which very few examples had. So this car, with the R2 supercharger and the 4-speed transmission, makes it among the rarest of these first-year Avantis. If you look at the interior compartment with this beautiful turquoise finish, that too is all original. This car has just 44,000 miles from new, meaning over the course of its life, it's been driven less than 700 miles for every year. Based on the records that we have on the car, it was originally sold new in Ohio and was in the same family across multiple generations before it was acquired by the Miles Collection and brought here to Motorland last year. When the Avanti was first introduced, if you look at these front lights, people either loved it or hated it. And to this day, 50 years later, that sentiment still rings true. For a sports car, it's actually surprisingly roomy in the back seat, so four adults could fit comfortably in a car that could go down the road for a Sunday afternoon cruise just as easily as it could perform on a racetrack. Sadly, Studebaker was running out of gas when it introduced this beautiful new motor car to the world in 1963. And just 2 years later, Studebaker shut down operations in the United States in 1965. And the last Studebaker in the world came out of Canada just a year later. The Avanti design that you're looking at was so popular that several companies actually bought the rights to remake and manufacture a new line of Avantis after Studebaker had gone into bankruptcy and closed. In the 1970s, in the 1980s, and early 1990s, successive introductions of new Avantis came to the market. But they never matched the beauty, the power, and the popularity of the first factory Studebakers, as you see here.
In 1948, the Second World War was over, and our boys and girls were ready for large and beautifully sculptured cars. The roads they had to ride on were not the best, so there was a need for a heavy car that would carry the driver and the passengers in luxury and smoothness. That was the Buick.
Here's one of our favorite cars at Motorland from the Miles Collection. Our 1948 Buick Super Convertible. After World War II ended and civilian production resumed of automobiles, General Motors, along with in 1948, the advertising slogan was, "When better automobiles are built, Buick will build them." And this is certainly a better automobile. Looking at the split window windshield, looking at the chrome trim, pop those out to open up the hood. Features the spotlight accessory, popular in that era. The old 6-volt batteries couldn't generate that much lumens from the headlights, so having a spotlight helped. The fender skirts and the beautiful design. The Buick Special was first introduced in 1936 and was a Buick favorite for many years. Buick was a top-of-the-line car for General Motors, just under Cadillac, so it was a prestigious buyer who could step into a Buick. The chrome, the wide white walls, popular of that era with the chrome rings, and a beautiful body captures the best of Buick for 1948. 28,297 convertibles were built by Buick,
and this was one of the most popular colors. This convertible has a power-operated top and power front seat and side windows. A true premium option for the era. The dash was attractive. A Buick radio, look at the buttons. They spelled the word Buick out. A clock mounted in. Looking at the front grille, you'll see that the hood opened from the side, either left or right. The Buick, straight eight. The Fireball, they called it the Dynaflash 8. Offering a lot of powers, and with today's collectors, that straight eight is one of the preferred and favorite motors. The Buick Special in the 1940s was assembled at one of two plants, either at Buick City in Flint, Michigan, the home of Buick, or at the Southgate Assembly in Southgate, California. That popular powertrain, the straight eight, was a 4.1 liter overhead valve, 248 cubic inch. The wheelbase is 122 inches. The 1948 was the last of the pre-war body styles. A brand new Buick would come out the next model year, 1949.
We invite you to Motorland in Arundel, Maine, and the Maine Classic Car Museum. On behalf of Miles, Tom, Tim, Phil, and Brandon, we would like to thank you for watching our show. Our web address is motorlandtvnetwork.com. See you next week.